Welcome back to Nucleotide Metabolism on Catalyst University. My name is Kevin Tokoph. Please make sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel for future videos and notifications. In the previous couple of videos, we looked at the biosynthesis of purines. And what we saw in the first video, so two videos ago, was the synthesis of IMP. This was a fairly complicated process from ribose 5-phosphate to get IMP. And then the IMP we saw in the second video could be shunted into one of two pathways. One will give you adenosine monophosphate, and the other will give you guanosine monophosphate. And we went into some brief talks on the regulation of this part of the pathway, but now what I want to do is actually take a step back and look at all of the regulation of this entire pathway. So let me kind of introduce you to this figure. Okay, remember in the first video we started with ribose 5-phosphate. So in this we start with ribose 5-phosphate, and we see that PRPP synthetase, which also has another name you may see, ribose phosphate pyrophosphokinase, converts ribose 5-phosphate into PRP. The second enzyme, which I mentioned was also allosteric, is glutamine PRPP amidotransferase, which converts PRPP to 5-phosphoribosylamine. Now again, in those nine steps after that to convert this to IMP, there's no allosteric regulation. But once we get to IMP, I talked about these two enzymes being allosteric. So both adenylosuccinate synthetase and IMP dehydrogenase, these are both also allosteric enzymes. All right, so let's think about for a minute two of the end products of this pathway, which we're going to consider to be AMP and GMP. I've already mentioned that AMP comes back and feeds back, I should say, and inhibits its own synthesis. So remember, I mentioned in the previous video that one thing that cells like to do is balance the amount of the purines that they have. In other words, you have two major purines, adenine and guanine, so A's and G's. And so the cell wants to balance the A's and the G's as much as possible. If you start to have way too many A's, then you need to stop making A's and make more G's. Makes sense. If you've got too many G's, or you've got at least enough G's, you can stop making G's and then make more A's, because the cell's going to want to keep those as balanced as possible. So the logic here is when you finally get AMP, it will come back and inhibit its own synthesis by allosterically inhibiting adenylosuccinate synthetase, which effectively shuts down its own synthesis and allows IMP to be diverted towards the right here to make GMP. Again, the reverse is also true. GMP is going to also inhibit its own synthesis by allosterically inhibiting IMP dehydrogenase. And again, that makes sense because if you have too many G's floating around, then you don't need to make any more G's. You can shut down its own synthesis, and then that IMP can be diverted towards the left here to make more AMP, again, in an attempt to balance the total amount of nucleotides. But let's also consider for a moment, let's talk about these two allosteric enzymes up here, because these are also regulated in many cases by the same mechanism. First, let's look at glutamine PRPP amidotransferase, because this is regulated in very much the same way. Now we're going to consider three end products, because we've already considered AMP and GMP. Those are two. We're also going to consider IMP an end product. So it turns out that AMP, GMP, and IMP, all three of these, can actually feed back and inhibit allosterically glutamine PRPP amidotransferase. All right, let's talk about the logic of inhibiting glutamine PRPP amidotransferase in this way. We've already mentioned that the cell likes to balance its A's and G's, okay? And presumably, unless you've got some horrible homeostatic imbalance, the A's and G's are always going to be pretty balanced, okay? One of these is not just going to rise way above the other and just stay that way, okay? They'll be relatively balanced at any given time. And we've already mentioned that AMP can come back and feedback inhibit adenylosuccinate synthetase, and GMP can feedback and inhibit IMP dehydrogenase. These two enzymes, being allosteric, provide that means of balance. But what happens if AMP and GMP both start to rise up to a significant extent? Well, they're both going to feed back and inhibit glutamine PRPP amidotransferase. And why is that? Because if you already got plenty of A's and G's floating around, then there's no reason to make any more A's and G's. And this enzyme is one of the committed steps in that process. So turn it off. Now let's talk about the logic of allosterically regulating glutamine PRPP amidotransferase. Well, we've already mentioned that A's and G's are relatively balanced in any cell, and barring some horrible homeostatic imbalance, they're going to remain pretty balanced, okay? AMP can feedback and inhibit its own synthesis. GMP can feedback and inhibit its own synthesis, okay? But what would happen if both of these being balanced started to rise up at the same time? So you're having both elevated AMP and GMP. Well, like we said, they're going to inhibit their own synthesis. So in that case, if both AMP and GMP are elevated, then both adenylosuccinate synthetase and IMP dehydrogenase are going to be shut down, allosterically inhibited. So if that's the case, if both of these enzymes are shut down, what's going to happen initially to IMP levels? They're going to rise because the IMP is not going to be able to be converted in either one of these two pathways because both these two steps, these committed steps right here, are inhibited. So IMP levels will start to build up. So IMP can come back and inhibit glutamine PRPP aminotransferase, which is going to slow down this enzyme and prevent as much accumulation of IMP. Additionally, if AMP and GMP levels are still built up, they can come back here and also inhibit glutamine PRPP aminotransferase. And in fact, if any one of these binds, only one of them, it only is a partial inhibition of this enzyme. It actually, for complete inactivation of glutamine PRPP aminotransferase, it actually takes all three of these molecules binding to allosteric sites on this enzyme for this enzyme to really lose activity. With each successive one that binds, you get more and more inactivation. So one of these binds, let's say just AMP, you have partial inactivation. If AMP and GMP, for example, both bind, then you have a little more inactivation. But if all three of these bind, that's going to completely shut off this enzyme. And so the fact that you have three allosteric regulators, all of which act negatively on glutamine PRPP aminotransferase, allows a way to modulate the activity in increments, depending on how much activity of this enzyme you actually need. All right, enough on this one. Let's go back to this one, PRPP synthetase, which recall is the enzyme that converts ribose 5-phosphate into PRPP, phosphoribosylpyrophosphate. Now the regulation on this enzyme is a little bit different because in some sources you may not actually see this enzyme as directly a part of IMP synthesis. In some cases it's separate because there are other processes that use PRPP. For example, NAD synthesis or pyrimidine biosynthesis, they also use PRPP. So in some cases, it may be separate. That's why the regulation of this looks a little bit different. This is dependent on ADP. So we have adenosine monophosphate here. AMP can actually be converted into ADP by the action of nucleoside diphosphate kinase. That's what this reaction is trying to show here. We'll talk more about that enzyme later on. But NDPK, or nucleoside diphosphate kinase, can convert AMP into ADP. And then ADP can inhibit this enzyme. Why does it make sense for ADP to inhibit this enzyme? Well, let's think about what conditions you would want to actually start building nucleotides of any type, whether it's pyrimidines, purines, or even in the case of NAD biosynthesis. It would be a case of high energy charge when you're in a fed state. It's always going to occur, but it's going to occur predominantly when you are in a fed state and have plenty of energy, high energy charge around the cell. So if you have tons of ATP floating around and really have a high ATP to ADP ratio, then you're going to want this enzyme on. However, if you start to fall into a low energy charge state where you're not going to be manufacturing nucleotides, then you're probably going to have a higher ADP to ATP ratio, meaning you're going to have a lot of low energy charge molecules like ADP floating around the cell. Okay, and if you have lots of ADP floating around the cell, as we mentioned, it's an indicator of low energy charge and basically a situation where you're not going to want to be focusing energy on making more nucleotides. You're probably going to be wanting to focus that effort that the cell is exerting on making energy, not making, you know, nucleotides and doing biosynthesis. So ADP is going to make sense as an inhibitor of PRPP synthetase. And this is the primary allosteric regulator of this enzyme. So if the ratio of ADP to ATP is high, then that's going to facilitate the inhibition of PRPP synthetase because you have lots of ADP. But if you flip it and have a high ATP to ADP ratio, then you have lots of ATP floating around and this enzyme will be active, considering also that ATP is a substrate for this enzyme. In conclusion of this video, purine biosynthesis has four regulatory points. We have PRPP synthetase, which may or may not be considered as actual part of this pathway, but in some cases it is. But we also have glutamine PRPP aminotransferase, a heavily regulated enzyme with modular inhibition, because you can have any one of these threes or combination of these three molecules bind, and you can have different levels of inhibition to the point where all three of these bind, and this enzyme is going to be maximally inhibited. But also, once we get IMP, we can also regulate which purine we're actually making more of. Because, like we said, we got to balance our A's and our G's. If one starts to rise, we need to inhibit its own synthesis and promote the other. So if A's start to rise, we need to inhibit A and stimulate the synthesis of G. And vice versa, it's also true. And it also makes sense that the committed steps in these two pathways, meaning adenylosuccinate synthetase and IMP dehydrogenase, it makes sense that those are the regulated steps. So try to make some sense of this figure, make some sense of how the regulation actually works, because what you'll find is that it's actually very logical. All right, please make sure to like this video and subscribe to my channel for future videos and notifications. In the next set of videos in this playlist, we're going to start going over a little bit of pyrimidine biosynthesis. Thank you. See you then.